Hey guys, today I'm going to show you how I went about making this mold that I've already actually started put to use for the side skirt extensions that I've designed for the R34. As you may have seen already, I've got a set of prototypes on my skyline, but since I've refined some of the dimensions. Down the road I'm planning to sell these together with the rear bumper extensions that I've also designed as a kit, but for now I just want to get some experience in mold making and have the finished product on my own car. If you have an R34 with GTR side skirts and rear bumper and are interested in these parts, you can always shoot me an email. But enough of that, let me show you what I've done. I started by laying out all the parts I 3D printed. I use as always my Ender 3 V2 with regular PETG I buy off Amazon. One extension consists of 10 different individual parts. On each end I added a small recess so I can connect them via pins that I've also 3D printed. I drilled out all the holes because there was some support material left and that had to be removed before I could insert the pins. These parts are printed with very basic settings. 0.24mm layer height, 2 wall lines and 10% infill. I use these settings because I only need the part to hold its outer shape and so I don't waste too much material. If I wanted to make a more durable part, I'd obviously change those settings a lot. I gently tapped in the pins with a small hammer, but I had to be real careful because the aforementioned print settings meant that I could easily damage the part if I didn't really pay attention. I laid out a plastic film underneath so I could start gluing them together. I used a very strong 2K epoxy glue that sets in just 5 minutes. And then I repeated everything for the other side. The second extension I decided to assemble on the ground, because due to the overhang on the workbench, the board was not perfectly flat and I didn't want to risk any distortion. Up next was smoothing out the surface of the assembled extensions. I started off by gluing the extensions down to an MDF board. I used an extra board to have them glued perfectly straight so when I start adding material and that hardens, the extensions don't end up crooked in any way. Again, I laid down a plastic film and started to mix up some epoxy. The epoxy I'm using for the entire project is a regular all-purpose laminating epoxy. There are other more specialized epoxies and maybe even cheaper, but right now this is what I had on hand, and I've used this on a ton of projects so far. I gave both extensions a nice coat so every nook and cranny was closed up and I could follow it up with some glassfiber body filler. I figured it would stick to the epoxy much better than the PETG itself, and it turns out it was the way to go. After the epoxy cured, I quickly gave it a rough sand to knock down all the peaks and I started laying on the body filler. I sanded that down too and mixed up some more epoxy. The purpose of the second coat was to be a super thin closing coat that I can work with when making the mold on top of it. It left me with a nice glossy finish, not a perfect finish, but good enough for what I'm trying to do. In theory, you could spend much more time perfecting the shape at this point if you're looking for the absolute perfect molds. For me, it was good enough, as this was my first attempt ever at making a mold. In order to get a nice mold with flanges, as well as it being able to stand nice and flat, I built a box out of coated MDF panels. I measured and marked everything up and started cutting the bits to size. They're especially nice for mold making because the surface is very smooth and with a few chemicals in between, epoxy or in our case, the gel coat will not be sticking to it at all. As always, my father-in-law has been helping me wherever he can. so I made sure to quickly clean up wherever I can in between, so my in-laws wouldn't kick my ass for continuing to make things dirty in their workshop. I popped off all the extensions from the boards and cleaned up all the edges after the final epoxy coat. I lined them up on the panel, which I am going to make the box from, because it would be easier to line and weigh them down like that before I built out the entire box. I mixed up the same 2K epoxy glue as before and applied it to the backside of the extensions. I literally took random heavy parts that were knocking about to make sure it didn't move for about 5 minutes while the glue was setting. As soon as that was done, it was on to assembling the box itself. I simply pre-drilled a couple of holes all around and screwed the sidewalls of the box to the main panel, leaving me with my extensions nicely boxed in. In order to make it waterproof, I had to lay down a bead of silicone. It's regular cheap silicone, don't need anything fancy for it. A tool I can recommend are these sculpting ball tool things that help you leaving a nice curved bead. And if you're not an idiot like I am, you can even pull off the excess silicone after an hour or two, and not when it is almost completely set. The only thing left to do on this part of the process was putting on the filleting wax around the extensions so the gel coat wouldn't run under the part and create a mechanical lock. I essentially used the same tool as on the silicone with just a smaller ball to create a much smaller radius curve. To ensure a good release from the parts, I went for a system that was recommended to me by a friend. These release agents consist of a simple wipe-on priming wax, as well as a spray or brush-on PVA coat. As for the wax, I simply wiped it on thinly with a microfiber cloth and made sure to not miss any spots. All you gotta do is make sure it's not bunched up somewhere and that you have a nice, even, thin coat everywhere. You let it flash off for about 15 minutes until it becomes hazy and you can move on to the PVA. For the PVA, I just brush it on with a small brush and made sure the entire surface inside the box was covered. The nice thing about this PVA is that it is self-leveling, so it covers minor defects nicely. And you also only need one single coat. The only thing is that you have to make sure it's completely dry before moving on to the next stage. The spec sheet claims it's done after 10 minutes, but for me it was more like 45. But that might be due to the cold temperature in the workshop. I got a regular dark gray colored gel coat that you're supposed to spread evenly over the entire surface. It was my first time working with gel coat, and to be honest, it was not as much of a pleasure to work with as I hoped. Again, I believe due to the cold temperature, the gel coat I had was very thick and didn't spread as easy as it should have, I believe. I even gave it a dash of thinner so it would be easier to work with. Not sure if you're supposed to do that, but it worked just fine. After leaving it for at least a day, it was hardened to a rock-solid surface, ready to lay up a few coats of glass fiber reinforcement. I got myself a couple of rolls of two different weights chopped strand glass fiber mats. One roll was 100 grams emulsion bound, and the other was 300 grams powder bound. I'll get into why that's important to differentiate in a minute. I measured everything out and pre-cut just about everything apart from the last coat. The first glass fiber coat after the gel coat is always a coupling coat. The coupling coat requires a light, easy to consolidate sheet so you can press out all the air bubbles with your brush or roller. It's done so the hard gel coat has a solid reinforcement and doesn't chip away that easy. In my case, the 100 gram emulsion bound glass fiber worked like a charm. The emulsion holding the glass fibers together start to dissolve after soaking it with epoxy, making it super pliable and easy to remove air from underneath. After its coupling coat hardened, I followed up with a second coat of pre-cut 300 grams glass fiber. I quickly found that the 300 grams powder-bound glass fiber was much harder to work with, as the powder did not dissolve as nicely as the emulsion on the lighter glass fiber sheets. It doesn't matter though, a couple of air pockets won't make a difference at this point. These heavier glass fiber mats are just meant to reinforce the entire structure. For my third and final coat, I went for a full uncut sheet of 300 grams again to add even more rigidity to the mold. It wasn't quite easy to lay it down and wet it out in one go, so I cut it in half. I then laid it up nicely and let it cure completely. 2 days later, I popped it on the workbench and got to it. I trimmed off all the excess so I'll have a nice straight surface to put it on, and then I started to take the box apart so I could check out my new mold. After turning it around, the 3D printed extensions came off the panel and were still inside the mold. I started to remove all the wax and tried to get them out by jamming in a spatula or a wedge to let them release from the mold. But unfortunately, I had to damage them a tiny bit to get a good grip on them so I could take them out. But at the end of the day, they released perfectly from the mold. If you're interested in seeing how I initially designed these extensions, feel free to check them out in the cards.
Whew, this has been quite an undertaking. This entire process took me the better part of a month, but the result's pretty nice. Let's go have a look.
The surface came out quite nice. If you wanted to, you could go ahead and polish it up and further refine it if there are spots that you're not quite satisfied with. I, however, got straight into starting to get the first parts out of it. And in one of the coming videos, I'll be showing you how I went about it. I'll be trying a couple different ways. Stay tuned, and thanks for watching, guys. Bye.